Since I'm publishing a fiction book, it's been a while since I've had the state of mind to make a math video. So here's my bachelor's thesis on combinatorics. Combinatorics is my favorite kind of math. A lot of math problems are incomprehensible to laymen, but combinatorics problems are the kind you might ask elementary school kids. How many different ways are there to give 10 identical donuts to 5 kids? People without a degree can think about questions like that. My work in combinatorics inspired my mobile game, Duka. In my video about Duka, I explained the concept a little, but now let's dig into the Debron property. Nicolas Govert Debron was born in 1918 and died 2012. As a math professor, he came up with these super neato sequences, Debron sequences. Sequences with parentheses around them like this repeat. When you leave one side, you come back in the other side. Think Pac-Man. Given a natural number k and another natural number n, natural numbers are simple numbers, integers above zero, like 1, 2, 3, and so on. A Debron sequence of order n on a k-sized alphabet contains every n-length permutation of k elements precisely once. Whoa. Here's a super easy one, just the number 0. We can call it a Debron sequence of order 1 on a 1-sized alphabet because it contains the number 0 precisely once. A Debron sequence of order 2 on a 2-sized alphabet is a little cooler. 0, 0, 1, 1 has a pair of zeros, a 0, 1, a pair of 1s, and then, looping back around to the beginning of the sequence, 1, 0. Every 2-length permutation of 1s and 0s is in here precisely once. Here are more examples, with every 3-length permutation of 0s and 1s, and every 3-length permutation of 0s, 1s, and 2s. These sequences have some useful properties, but I'm a mathematician. I don't care how useful they are. Let's just study them and let the world deal with it. If I told you I could make a Debron sequence for every possible natural numbers k and n, would you believe me? Because here's a quick proof. Given k and n, let's just say 3 and 3, let's make a graph out of vertexes and directional edges. We've got a vertex with 2 zeros in a row, another vertex a 0 and a 1, a 0 and a 2, a 1 and a 0, 2 ones, a 1 and a 2, a 2 and a 0, a 2 and a 1, and 2 twos. These vertexes are connected to each other using arrows, directional edges, to show how, given 2 zeros, moving one space to the right, the next options might be 0, 0 again, 0, 1, or 0, 2. We can make a Debron sequence out of this graph if we can make a cycle starting and ending at the same vertex, covering every single edge precisely once. This is a Eulerian path. Euler was another mathematician. Lots of stuff is named after him. So this Eulerian path is related to this Debron sequence of order 3 on a 3-sized alphabet. How can we be sure this works for any order over any sized alphabet? Another mathematician, Heyerholzer, proved a connected graph has a Euler cycle if and only if every vertex has even degree. This is called Euler's theorem because Euler is much more famous than Heyerholzer. A vertex's degree is how many edges come out of it or lead into it. This loopy edge counts twice, both directions. No matter what we choose for k and n, every vertex has k edges out and k edges in. 2 times k is always even, so there's always a Debron sequence in here somewhere, usually lots, because there are lots of Eulerian paths. That's rad, huh? But it gets a little more rad. We can make more than just Debron sequences. Here are some Debron tori. Like a sequence loops back around beginning to end, a torus loops left to right and top to bottom. It's like a donut. These are donuts which have the de Bron property in two directions at once. Every 2x2 combination of white and black exists in these donuts, precisely once for each donut. On Wikipedia, there's this cool example, with every 4x4 combination of white and red precisely once. Unfortunately, de Bron tori like this aren't quite as flexible as de Bron sequences. You could make any de Bron sequence you want, we proved it, but not every K and N can lead to a de Bron torus like these ones. Here's an illustration of the complexity. These are the only two possible de Bron tori containing every 2x2 permutation of white and black. We could prove these are unique by trying every possible combination of white and black squares. There are only 2^16 combinations. A computer could handle that in seconds. But if we try to prove it by hand, it takes a few steps. I proved it by contradiction, and it covers 9 pages playing a little domino game with notation I invented. But there's no reason to stop at 2 dimensions, is there? Let's pick one of these folks, this one, say, and stack 16 of them on top of each other. Remember, each one of these is a donut. It looks two-dimensional, but it's looped around a third dimension. Let's make the whole stack a hypertorus, a super donut. So the first and last de Bron tori are connected across the fourth dimension. Then, if we nudge every layer around a bit, so every 2 consecutive layers has a unique relationship, we can turn this into a de Bron hypertorus. It contains every 2x2x2 combination of white and black precisely once. I made one of these out of Legos. It was super fun. In my bachelor's thesis, I prove there's no reason to stop there either. Now that we've got a 4-dimensional donut with the de Bron property, we can stick 256 of them together and connect them across the 5th dimension to make a 5-dimensional donut with the de Bron property. Then we can take 65,536 of those and make a 6-dimensional donut with the de Bron property, and so on. Every finite number of dimensions can have a de Bron hypertorus. So, what do these objects do? What good is a de Bron sequence or torus? Well, the best way to recombine a bunch of strips of DNA into the original DNA is using the least possible amount of repetition, just like pieces of a de Bron sequence are unique in position. A de Bron torus can be used to identify position in 2D space. By recognizing what we're looking at, we know exactly where we are on the map. Theoretically, higher dimensional tori could be used the same way. I imagine aerial drones in a warehouse navigating through a de Bron hypertorus. But after reading Alien Information Theory, these examples of usefulness aren't nearly pretentious enough for me. I want to take this mathematics in a bizarre, spiritual direction no one asked for. Life can be compared to Conway's game of life. If we could zoom in on quantum physics, maybe it would look like something this simple. But why is there something instead of nothing? There's something, so why isn't there everything? You've probably heard of the multiverse theory, the idea that many alternatives are represented somewhere else, in parallel dimensions, like multiple Conway's games of life playing at once. I figure if we step in this direction, we might as well go all the way. Reality is a de Bron hypertorus, where literally everything possible, or even imaginable, or even unimaginable, occurs precisely once. I'm obviously thinking too much about all this. It's all I do here at Thinkster. But numbers can be fun to think about. When I'm tired writing fiction, I can write numbers. And when I'm tired writing numbers, I can write more fiction. And sometimes the boundary between the two concepts begins to blur. What's your favorite 2x2x2 combination of zeros and ones? Mine is totally this one. It's a cutie. Bye-bye. By the way, I've got a Patreon at patreon.com/thinkster. I want to thank all these squidlings and elder squids. Thanks.